East. Kyle Corbin, the captain, was leg before wicket bowled by Dwayne Yearwood for 27 from 15 balls. And he had 6 fours. Cameron Pennyfeather was run out for 38 from 38 deliveries, 2 boundaries. Robin Powell was bowled by Bab for 30 from just 12 balls with 3 fours and 2 sixes. Jonathan Carter caught by Bab off Haynes for 51, 34 balls, 3 fours and 2 sixes. Kevin Hodge was stumped by Jamar Yearwood off Haynes for 10, 7 deliveries, 1 four. Ryan Hines now hooked 16 from 12 deliveries with 1 boundary. Nino Henry not hooked 5, 2 deliveries and 183 for 5 from 20 overs. There were 6 extras made of 1 by 3 leg-bys and wide, and the wickets fell at 45 after 4 overs and 3 balls. Corbin 80 for 2, Powell 7 overs and 3 balls, 146 for 3, 15 overs and 4 balls. Carter 160 for 4, 17 overs and 3 balls. Hodge. And then the last wicket going down at 179. The bowling, Eiffel 4 overs, no maidens, none for 40. Davis 2 overs, no maidens, none for 15. Dwayne Yearwood 2 overs, no maidens, 1 for 26. Bab 4 overs, no maidens, 1 for 47. Gooden 4 overs, 1 maiden, none for 24. And the Haynes 4 overs, no maidens, 2 for 27. For his impressions of the UWA innings, here's Ian Bradshaw, the former Barbados captain and West Indies fast bowling all-rounder.
The 2 standout innings there for the UWA team. Jonathan Carter, 51 from 34 balls. And Robman Powell, 30 from 12 balls. Those 2 innings really set up the UWA drive for a massive total. However, we saw a wonderful bowling by Stephen Gooden in association with Ashin Haynes, the 2 Osmonds pulling things back, only giving up 51 runs from their 8 overs. And that really allowed the police team to go in feeling that they have a chance. Runs on the board is always pressure, but in good batting conditions, outfield still fast enough despite the rain that we had earlier. I still believe that the police team can come and give a good account of themselves. The UWA team, they have a varied bowling attack, and the likes of Dwar and Ram Saram, they'll be looking to pin the police batting lineup, which we know is a bit suspect to spin. But you never know, with a wet ball, they may be a bit hampered in the ability to get the spin that they usually get.
So, the creases are being marked as usual. Peter Douglas has that job under control. No longer does he have his locks, but he tells me he's still Rastaman and once featured on Quick and Four during an international game. And this T20 stuff, you really don't have time sometimes to recover. And if you're weak in the field, as one would have realized here tonight, Ian, without trying to keep pinpointing individuals who may be over the hill in terms of being fleet-footed, etc. But Dwayne Davis, that has always been his size, you know. He's always been a very big man. He carries his weight pretty well. But when batsmen push balls to you under the lights in this version of the game, you really have to be with it. And it was clearly seen that he was targeted by the UWA batsmen.
Most certainly, the UWA team would have appreciated that there were some players in the police outfit that weren't the best in the field, and certainly they utilize that advantage they have. They are a much fitter team, the UWA team, and we can expect that they will give a better account of themselves in the outfield. However, the pressure of a quarterfinal can always lead to panic, whether it's from a batting perspective or from a bowling and fielding perspective. So it will be very much a team that can hold their nerve here tonight when the pressure comes on. I would expect that the police team chasing a target such as this, they will come out hard. They'll be looking to get probably in the region of 50, 60 runs in the power play to set up the middle part of the innings, where they may slow a bit with the introduction of the spinners.
And the critical thing here in relation to the police batting, they did qualify in a zone where it was tough, with three teams finishing on the same number of points, but they played all of their matches on the field and BDFSP, according to the rules of the competition, despite a superior net run rate, would have missed out. YMPC were the other team. They all had 12 points, but YMPC and BDFSP, one of their three victories for those two teams, would have come by way of a forfeiture by Guardian General Barbados Youth due to that boycott of the first two rounds by the Barbados Association of Principals of Public Secondary Schools over an issue with team selection, bearing in mind that Combermere and Foundation were the other two school teams involved, and they wanted to both field full strength teams, and that was that as it stood. But generally, looking through the police batting, there have been only two half centuries. Richie Graves got 59 against BDFSP in the second round, and Brian Corbin 74 against YMPC. They had a close result over Barbados Youth, and on paper, the likes of Roger Williams, Richard Graves, Dwayne Yearwood, Brian Corbin, Larry Babb, those are the main batters. Stephen Gooden really hasn't been able to get going, but he's one who can really strike the ball. They've dropped Dion Broom for this game. Jamar Yearwood, the keeper, has had three innings and just one run. So a lot will depend, Ian, on the captain, Williams, who's not 100% fit, came in to this match under cloud, having hurt his shoulder at practice on Tuesday. And this target, one reckons, is going to be tough, because by and large, the police, the UWA bowling has been generally tight. You look at a guy like Kevin Hodge, figures of 4 overs, no maidens, 1 for 9 against Spartan. Picked up 1 for 13 against Empire, again from 4 overs. Was extremely mean while being effective with the ball as well against Carrollton. 4 overs, 1 maiden, 3 for 9. Against Lyme, 4 overs, 1 for 20. And against Combermere, 4 overs of 14 runs. Excellent stuff when it comes to T20 cricket.
Wonderful stuff by Hodge. And I understand that he is one of about three spinners that the UE team will use here tonight. And it's going to be critical that there's good running and rotation of the strike by the police team. As you said before, the batting isn't as deep as one would like. So those guys, those senior guys, will have to take on some responsibility, the likes of Brian Corbin and Williams and so forth, and hopefully set up the game for Mr. Larry Babb. Those who follow local cricket know that here's a guy who can change a game within a matter of overs. And if they can set up the game for Larry Babb to finish the inning strong, I think that will be key to a police victory here tonight.
The one bowler who fans should be excited to see here at Kensington Oval tonight is the Trinidadian Christopher Ramsaram. He is a Chinaman bowler, one more the likes of the late Inshanali. He's just not the ordinary left-arm spinner orthodox. And when you compare his figures with those of Hodge, 1 for 11 from 4 overs against Spartan. He then had 4 overs, 2 maidens, 3 for 9 against Empire. Empire, a team which didn't make the quarterfinals this time around, but have appeared in a record 4 finals in this, the 8th edition of the Sagicor General T20. And 2 for 22 before the wicket against Carrollton. That was the only game in which he got some licks, so to speak. And then he hit back against Lyme, 4 overs, 1 maiden, 3 for 16. And playing against his school side, Combermere, 4 overs, no maidens, 2 for 24. So Ramsaran and Hodge are going to be the key spinners. Kieron Kotoy, another guy who has been fairly tight with his stuff, as you can probably detect from the figures which I will read. 2 for 3 against Spartan, 1 for 29 versus Empire, 2 for 17 from 2 overs against Carrollton. And then he got a bit expensive against Lyme, 4 overs, 9 for 33. And against Combermere, 1 for 25 from 3 overs. Akeem Duwar, to my mind, is not the leg spinner as he was a couple of seasons back. And I had a discussion with both Floyd Reefer and the manager, Stephen Leslie. 2 seasons ago, in all versions of the game, he was the top bowler in local club cricket, but last season went off the ball, so he would want to prove a point here in this quarterfinal game. And Jonathan Carter, handy as usual with his medium pace. Jermaine Levy, the pacer from Jamaica, and Nino Henry, and another player. So those are the main bowlers that UWA will be using as they are now in a huddle in front of the Garfield Sobers Pavilion.
I keep one of the things that always is to UWA advantage is the fact that they are pulling players from across the region. So there's not that element of familiarity that a lot of teams have with their bowling in particular. And it'll be interesting to see how quickly the police can adapt to the varied styles of bowling that they will have to counter here tonight.
So that's the position. I see a strange looking fella making his appearance for the first time. He did play for the Barbados Cricket League, but no one ever remembers that. He's become a Maple Light for quite a number of years. Tends to be a lot on golf courses with big ups like Brian Lara and the chap who plays some football from Trinidad and Tobago down on the West Coast. But I allow him to give all of his pretty talk. Dwight York, that's the name we're searching for. I was about to say Clint York. Clint is the cricketer and Dwight is the footballer. So let's welcome for the first time Big Andy Payne, who I believe now when it comes to T20 cricket is a retiree.
Well, good night. Retiree, that's in every sense, Keith.
You mean even in golf?
Well, no, that's my newfound sport, and at this age, I'm just in my prime with it.
Your newfound sport. I would hope that you can explain to us what you mean by your newfound sport. Are you a caddy?
I'm a golfer.
Handicap?
Playing off a 12 handicap presently, Keith.
Okay. Where does that rank?
12 shots from a scratch player.
I think I may get myself in trouble if I try to search even deeper. The umpires are on the field, and this break has been one that I'm certain most would have welcomed, including Lyndon Yard, to fatten his face. You know, he's done a lot of talking from the very start, and the UWA players are out in the middle. Maple, your club, how confident are you that, you know, Maple can perhaps become the first team to win this Sagicor General T20 for a record 3 times? Hold the record at the moment with UWA. This is only the 8th edition, but 2 titles. And in recent years, you've played good cricket, not only from a T20 perspective, but Super 50, as well as the league competition now called the Elite 3-Day Championship.
Well, very confident, Keith, especially in this shortened format. I think the guys are even a lot more confident in this version of the game. We have a lot of all-round players, and this form really suits their style of play.
So the UWA players are out in the middle, and the two police openers, they're seemingly a starting wrong. You look at Richie Graves in a gold shirt and his opening partner in a pronounced blue with a gold stripe. Andy Payne can explain that, and he'll be joined by Lyndon Yard. I think when you're representing police as a uniform unit, you really cannot at this level, and it's the quarterfinals here at Kensington Oval, television cameras, etc., and you're wondering why contrasting outfits.
Well, Keith, you know, in the Premier League and that sort, you see the guy with the higher amount of runs, he might be wearing the orange cap. So I don't know if this is what's happening in the police setup, where Richie is wearing the gold shirt.
Yes, good night to you, Andy. Good to have you in the box. And the Sagicor UWI side are pretty much out in the field. And they can tell you that they're going to start with the pace of Nino Henry. And opening the battling for the police side, Roger Williams, and with him is Richard Graves. So it's going to be the field, slip, third man, point cover, mid off, and this first deal is a gem of a deal. The people caught behind, and Richard Graves is on his way back. He goes back just as slow as he took to get to the wicket. His vigil for the night is over. He's been adjudged caught behind. A peach of a delivery to start by Nino Henry, and not the kind of start that police would have wanted, but perfect for UWI.
Good delivery, pitching just about on the off stump on a good length. Good carry as well to the keeper. But Richard Graves, again, and Keith instead in the gold shirt. And another player coming up in the gold shirt. So I don't know what's the plan here for the uniform men, so to speak. But a very good delivery to start that one. Put UWI right on track to start.
And caught behind by Justin Bramble, the keeper, for Sagicor UWI. So a perfect start for them. And it was a delivery on a good length, and he sparred at it. Lack of foot movement, and this is the only thing that is very evident I notice these days, and you don't know how much cricket you've been watching lately. But a lot of openers these days don't get behind the line of the ball, just stand there and spar, especially in this version of the game. But it still takes a batsman to understand the role of a batsman, not because it's a T20, you're just going to have a bash.
And I agree. I mean, coming out to face the first ball, you need to get yourself in good batting positions. It's just getting yourself back and feeling the ball onto the bat. But as you said, Graves, no kind of foot movement and just sparring at that one. And that's not what you want to see at the top of your order for opening bat.
And here's an original opener, Dwayne Yearwood in at three, and probably at three for his experience. And he waits on Henry, who goes past umpire Corbin, and this delivery's outside in the yard stump, and he plays a naughty shot. Straight away looking to play the ball down in the angle, and they always say early in your innings, you want to play the ball in the V, mid-off, mid-on. And it was a delivery that, as an opener bat, I'm sure you would have been better off just picking up the line and allowing it to go through the keeper.
Agreed, but this guy Henry seems to be just there ball on the off stump. A good line to start with. He's got himself a slip in the gully. So the UWI team looking to attack right away, and that's a good move. So I think Henry's just bowling to that.
And he moves away from us to bowl to Yearwood, and Yearwood gets a short delivery, hooks it in the air. Fine leg comes across, and it lands in safe proximity. And he'll turn and come back for... They don't come back. Actually, they turn and thought about two. But in the end, Yearwood electing to go back to the non-strikers. And fortune favors the brave. He opens his account with one, not in control of that hook. And as a matter of fact, throughout his career, he's never been very comfortable with the short ball. So, Andy, I am one of these people who believe that in T20, especially, is horses for courses.
Agreed. And if you said that, I get Williams, he's supposed to be one of the better suited players in the police team.
In the air, down to third man, coming across, and the ball goes off the edge, and it's peeled off the edge straight into the stand, and not what you would call a conventional shot, but one that has brought about a boundary, and I'm sure that the police are going to take them however they're going to come. And Ashane Haynes opens his account with a six, so just a change around, actually. We were saying that it was Williams and Graves, but it is Haynes, and as the opening bats, I thought that he looked a little short. Oh, pull through mid-wicket, slap for four, short delivery. And as I said, this is the first time I'm seeing this young man. He did bowl particularly well tonight, but no seeing him for the first time as a batsman. And Andy, he just stood there. You would be pleased with that shot as a golf player yourself.
Tell you what, that was a telling shot. I mean, haven't seen this guy Haynes before, but he seems a very aggressive player. And that shot, that was hit with disdain through the mid-wicket area.
Well, he's up to 10. And just been told he went to school at the Allen School, Ashane Haynes. As Nino Henry moves in from the sudden and goes into bowl to Haynes. And Haynes is onto the front foot, stops the ball in front of him, goes for a very quick single. Very, very good intelligent cricket.
That's well played again. After playing that shot with such disdain earlier, I think they would just push the field back a bit. And Haynes playing it with soft hands, nicely into the cover, and an easy single on the offering.
And that has moved the police side at the completion of the first over up to 12 for one. And the assertion a target of 184 for victory. And pretty tall order, but I think under circumstances at 107 for two. I think that the 107 for one, sorry, the police side will be satisfied to chase down a target of 184.
And he and Ian Bradshaw speak a little earlier about this top order. They just need to stay in there and get themselves some partnership and set it up for the lights to come. I mean, you've got the lights of Baron Corbin, who can have a hit. We all know Larry Bob, what he's capable of doing. So, yeah, this top order just needs to get themselves in, get a partnership going, and put the UWI team under a bit of pressure.
And Hodges is going to pick it up from the Joel Garner end, and he will be bowling his first delivery to Haynes. And it's a delivery which ricochets off the pad. The keeper skips across from behind the stump in Bramble and has it under control. It remains 12 for 1. The target 184. If the lawmen are going to advance to the semi-final stage, there's a drive back to the bowler by Haynes. So Haynes seems to have some aggressive intent about him. Sells into his stance and now pulls away. The field slip, backward point cover, mid-off. as Hodge is into Haynes onto the back foot, forces it out to the fielder. And oh my lord, he's run out. Haynes has been run out, taking a sharp single, or really a non-existent single, to the fielder at the point position. And he came across to his left pretty quick and intercepted. And Haynes has been stranded, run out for 11. It is 12-1. 12-1 becomes 12-2. Andy, they're in trouble.
They're in trouble. Just into the second over. Haynes just playing that one. Just a battery point he set about. I think he saw some response from the non-striker Yearwood. But then Yearwood had a stop. Haynes couldn't get back. A good return to the keeper. And that's where he found himself wanted. Put a lot of pressure on them at this stage. Two wickets down, only in the second over, chasing the big target. They're really on the back foot, Yardy.
Yes, most definitely they're on the back foot. And run out by Carter. And it is Dario Sargent who's going to come to the crease. So I would say at the moment that the policemen are getting to the crease pretty quickly. Already back in the hutch, Richard Graves didn't trouble to score. First ball duck, caught by wicketkeeper Bramall off the board of Henry. Got a peach of a delivery, just part of it. He'd gone back, not a run was on the board. And Ashay Haynes was run up by Jonathan Carter for 11. And that 11 included 1-4 and 1-6. And it is 12-2. And remember, the target is 184. Police would have won the toss tonight, earliest night, and asked the Sagicor UWA to take first knock. As Sargent, to his first delivery, is playing it up on the onside, up to the fielder at the shortish mid-on position, and actually mid-wicket position, straightish. There's a long on in place, deep mid-wicket, short mid-wicket, square leg, and the fielder behind square, short fine leg. So Hodge has been very tight. I think he picked up 4 against Carlton for Spit, and this delivery brings Sargent onto the front foot, turns it into Yorker, the end of the second maiden of the game, the first of this half. And I can tell you that police in search of a target of 184. They are presently 12 for the loss of 2. Graves no score. Haynes 11. Yearwood is in 1. Sargent yet to score. Henry 1 over for 12 runs with 1 wicket. And Kevin Hodge 1 over. That was a maiden.
Yep, Hodge left arm. Dots just coming in, bowling it nice, wicket and wicket. The lengths, batsmen can't seem to get him off the square. But it's the lines that you want to bowl, especially with the new ball, just like none. Seems like he's coming in a bit with the arm. So good lengths to start.
And here is Henry, moves in on the way and bowls to Yearwood. And Yearwood comes onto the front foot and checks his shot and gets a very quick single, playing it with soft hands. And a good response by the non-striker in Dario Sargent. 13-2.
Yep, well played this time, Yearwood. Again, field seems to be a bit deep for the at the cover area, and the point area. So if you play it nice and easy and soft, the single is always there on the offering.
And the ball is very much back with Henry. It is 13-2 in the process of the third over. 2.1 overs gone to be exact. As Henry is on his way into bowl to Sargent. Sargent gets a short, if he works it onto the leg side, will pick up a single to the fielder at the mid wicket position. Coming in, can't prevent the single. 1 move total, 14 for loss of 2.
I think that's what this pair needs to do now, Yardy. Just try to hang in there, build a partnership, don't lose any more wickets in the next 3-4 overs. Just try to score 6 runs or over or so. Just give the guys behind something to work with. You don't want to be losing too many overs in the power play. That always sets the team back as you're chasing runs.
Yearwood on strike as Henry's into him and he flashes it slightly off stump. A good short delivery on a good length, good pace, good carry to the keeper who muffed it. He put it down, but it wasn't a catch. And there's a booming drive by Yearwood, nowhere near the ball.
Again, Henry seems to be a bit of pace coming out of Henry. And he's going on good lines just down that off stump quarter. And again, the keeper didn't even take that. Good carry.
So it is 14-2. And over number 3, the target 184, as Henry's on his way and bowls to Dwayne Yearwood, and he flashes a cut outside the awesome. Doesn't make any contact through to the keeper, and this is going to be the first free hit of the night as a no ball, as Henry infringed the front crease. And I think this is one way of releasing the pressure, Andy.
He needs to cash in here. I mean, he's been playing some shots that are not on, a little pace on the off stump. And this one's carrying to the keeper, but with a free hit, he just needs to cash in here. So this is a very good opportunity for Yerwa to have a free scoring shot.
As Henry will continue. And he moves in on the way into bowl to Yearwood. And Yearwood is down the wicket and flashes it through cover point for four. Magnificent shot. And Andy, something had to give. The previous two deliveries stood his ground and flashed and missed. And this time he gives him the charge, gets the room, and gets back on the ball for 19 for two.
Yeah, the opportunity of that free hit just presented itself. And Yearwood had all the freeness to play that shot. It was a good shot. I mean, giving himself some room and crashing it through the cover point area. Very good shot from Yearwood on that occasion.
So it is 19 for two. Slip. It's a backward point. Sweeper on the cover point position. Yeah, cover, mid off, mid on, mid wicket, square leg as Nino Henry moves in on the way and Bozy versus driven by Dwayne Yearwood. Excellent shot through extra cover. They've gone for one, going to go pretty close to the boundary. The fielder puts in the slide and overhauls it. And they'll come back for two. So he started with two dot balls and suddenly he's gotten back on the ball. I think that's the important part. He moves to eight. It is 21 for loss of two.
And yes, Yardi, this Dwayne Yearwood, he would have to be one of the more experienced players in the putting lineup. So he needs to be there for some length of time. He could have also played for the Barbados team in the original one they turned at some time. So he needs to be there.
And he waits on Henry, who goes past the umpire, and this delivery is a yorker left and flicked away. A lovely shot for four. He loses the keeper who really had no chance. Bramble only to turn and look at it. The fielder from square leg will go to retrieve. And at the completion of the day's third over, the second half of this innings, where police haven't won the toss and are in search of a target of 184. They're 25 for the loss of two. Yearwood has 12 with him. Is Dario Sargent. He is on one.
Yes, 25 to two after three overs. They're very much in there on the scoring of the runs. The run rate is good. But like they said, two wickets down in the first three. These two needs to really consolidate and stay in. Instead, to the end of the power play, at least Gary, to really give themselves a real chance at it.
Yes, they still have a fair amount of batting to come in. Larry Babb, who we know can hit at the wrong. Brian Corbin, not as agile as he uses to be. And there is Sargent onto the back foot and playing from the crease. And I think what they will have to do here, if they're going to get this target, they have to pick bowlers to go after, because Hodge is usually very tight. 1.1 over and is yet to concede a run. And yet to concede a run in 1.2 overs. So they have to find some bowlers to go after, because you cannot afford that. They're going to be protected at both ends. Henry's gone for 25 from his two over. He's picked up one wicket as Hodge bowls in the region. Whip the square leg. Chance for a run out. And would you believe it? Dario Sargent goes back to the pavilion. There's a saying that pressure burst pipe. And there is Dario Sargent looking to get away from the strike. And it was a saying, you have to pick a bowler to go after, because clearly he isn't reading Hodge. And Hodge, in his returns thus far, has been very tight in the tournament and suicidal at either end. And in the end, the big man once again makes his way off the square. And you can tell that police are in further trouble. 25 for loss of three.
Very suicidal around that. Yardi, again, just played strictly, maybe kick. Just took off like he was going, I don't know, like a train down the track. But that was no random offer. And again, this Hodge, very tight bowling it wicket to wicket, nice and straight. And these guys doesn't seem to have a clue how they will get a single. So that's also building to the pressure. Now you've seen two runouts coming from that end. So it means that he's really on sound and the batsmen just have to stay around. But find the gaps. Obviously they're not doing that and they're panicking a bit and running themselves out, so to speak.
Well, it is 25 for loss of three. The new batsman in, just trying to ascertain. And it's going to be Hodge. And he bowls to Yearwood and he plays a late cut. Magnificent shot. Using the pace of the ball. And that's the first delivery that Hodge has actually bowled outside the off. And he pushed it through. And there's Dwayne Yearwood having the sense of purpose and awareness to use the pace of the ball with an open face back and picked up what is his third boundary. And he is now 16, is 29 for three.
Again, showing his experience, he used the pace of the ball again. This one was a little bit of whiff on offer. And he cashed in there and played it right in the gap. And it was a good shot.
So he has 16 from 9 deliveries, 3 fours. And with him is at the non-striker's end. Looks like the walk alone suggests, yes, the song, the song, Wait Up. In his old familiar way, Brian Corbin. So he's come out and he can push it. He can hit it around, but usually it's a play itself in. 29 for the loss of three. Over number four in progress. And this one is ticked away. A lovely shot. He loses the feel at the short front leg. He has to turn around and chase. That is Akeem Duwar. And he has his return into the keeper. And Dwayne Ewart helps himself to two. So at the completion of the fourth over, it is now 31 for loss of three. With Dwayne Ewart not out on 18. Brian Corbin is yet to face and he's yet to score. And they can tell that Kevin Hodge is now both overs. One maiden, none for six.
Hodge again starting the over pretty tight, nice and straight. Hit again at Yardie. But when he offered any whiff that time, you saw Yearwood, Dwayne Yearwood, that is, getting under the back foot and playing that 1-2 point, a good shot. Straight a bit on the leg this time, and he just worked that one down to short, fine leg for two. So that's the way to play. You just stay in, and when he gives you something, you cash in. But you don't just run yourselves out like you see the first student in the first overs, putting the team under too much pressure.
Well, there's a slight meeting in middle wicket between Kyle Corbin, Jonathan Carter, and Ryan Hines. You can say the senior pros.
Senior pros.
And it is going to have a bowling change. Yes, it's going to be Jonathan Carter who's going to come into the top.
Useful at this level. I mean, Carter, we used to say they have golden arm whenever he comes on, gets wickets. So, three down and Carter coming to goal. I think he's really in the ascendancy. But you see Brian Corbin about to face his first one up, yeah?
And he waits for Carter, who's in from the Malcolm Marshall end. And bowls a short delivery. And there's a people caught behind. Up goes the finger. Brian Corbin gesticulates to the umpire in not good police fashion. But what I can tell you, while he's gesticulated, he's also making his way back to the pavilion. He's looking at his elbow, and he goes back for the golden duck. It's the second golden duck of this in his police. There are all sorts of trouble here at the Mecca. Seeking a target of 184, they are 31 for a loss of four. Brian Corbin's vigil lasted no longer than Richard Graves, only separated by minutes. One lasted no minutes. The next lasted 3 minutes, but they both scored out.
Yeah, there was a time when I played Yardie, and whenever Corbin came in the back, the guys would just bowl it short. Short of length delivery, working on his body. They just fend it off to the keeper. He didn't think he liked the decision given from umpire Corbin, but you know, once the umpire signals that, that's the thing.
Yes, I agree with you, and that's why you say, Andy, this game is pretty much horses for courses. And not a lot of cricketers are cut out for the T20 format, and that's a delivery where it wasn't a short delivery of any particular merit, but a good batsman who would have loved to hook, say, a Philo Wallace or Ron Bakes. In their young days, of course, that would have been meat and drink.
Not if it was bowled by you, Yardie.
Well, you pick horses with courses. And Brian looking to work himself in. The new batsman in is Captain Roger Williams, and he has his face his first delivery. And strides onto the front foot, gets the ball off the inner portion of the bat, out to square leg. He will pick up one. So he opens his account, and now a lot rests on his shoulder. And looking down the order, I am going no further than Larry Babb.
Well, a lot of people would say that this is probably the batting for the police team, Williams and Yearwood. These two would have probably scored majority of runs for police over the last couple of years. But again, he have to do a lot here.
And it is Jonathan Carter. Right on medium pace. It goes past umpire Andrew Corbin. It was a short delivery, which is pulled through mid wicket by Dwayne Yearwood. It goes pretty close to the boundary. The field is after. He will overhaul it. And Yearwood will return to come back for his second run, which will carry him to 20. And in the process of the fifth over, the police side have moved it to 34 for a loss of two. And 20 of those to Dwayne Yearwood. And 11 to Shea Haynes to be the only double figure contributors. Short delivery, turned away off the glove, down to the keepers across to his left. That is Bramble. And police helped themselves by 1 to 35 for 4. But clearly being pegged back here, Andy. And this is one the major way to build pressure is to get wickets.
Wickets always puts pressure on any team batting and chasing, especially this team, UE team, really in the ascendancy. And they should feel comfortable at this stage.
Carter on his way in was a short delivery, and there is Roger Williams pulling it down to the fielder off the fine leg boundary. And he has his return to the keeper, and they will take one.
These two batters are a lot more assured and equipped to take on the short bowling, or the shorter ball than Corbin was, and that's known throughout the country.
Well, I guess he has a shadow that follows him around.
And people capitalize on it.
When you see him get a big score, you wonder who was bowling. I think it is very important to know the strengths and weaknesses of the opponents. As Carter moves in underway and bowls to Yearwood. Yearwood runs the delivery off the open face down to the fielder at the point region. I suspect that is Katoi, but I don't know. I want to stick my neck out at the moment. He's trying to pick up the players one by one as they go along. So continue at the completion of the fifth over. Police 36 for the loss of four. They are in trouble. And it is Katoi. So 10 points for me. And 36 for four, chasing a target of 184 for victory.
At this point, again, a lot of four wickets down at this stage, really setting the Police team back in a run chase. But you got to give all the credit to Yui. The bowl pretty tight. Hodge, his two overs, you've seen him bowl nice and straight. Henry, a bit of pace to start, even though he's proved a bit expensive at the end. But Carter, like I said, we used to see this guy with a golden arm, and you saw him coming first ball, and there was a wicket for him.
And it's going to be Hodge to continue. And struck on a pass, the P for leg before umpire Michael Nurse hasn't made a decision for the entire night. And he doesn't. He keeps that 100% record intact. Not out is the verdict. As Williams was struck on the back foot. As Katoi. Peel once again is turned down. So just to make an adjustment to the scorecard, Ashane was run out by Katoi. Run out by Katoi for 11. This is worked up to long on for a single. So one more to the Police cause. 36 for the loss of four in the process of the sixth over. And the current rate is 7.20. The required rate is 9.87. And they always say, Andy, the required rate is always has that much amount of pressure to the battle. And there is Dwayne Williams pelting back literally and figuratively. Dwayne here was sorry. The outside lady all stump. Interesting, Andy. You meant to flash it square, but the bat headed to mid wicket. Can you explain that?
A lot of moisture around. The mittens must be a bit wet. And that at the time it got away from him. But, you know, playing under the lights, Yardy, lots of moisture at this time.
And I've been told from some of the players as well that the lights generate a significant amount of heat.
Yeah, under the lights, it's very hot. And like I said, lots of moisture. The mix, if you're in for any length of time, it could really get slippery.
Hodge on his way into Yearwood. And Yearwood is flicking at Divi down the leg side. Wide signal by umpire Michael Nurse. One more to the total. It's now 38 for loss of four.
Hodge just losing his line on that time. Just trying to get as straight as possible. Aiming it a bit down the leg.
2.4 overs, one maiden, none for eight. And now the appeal for a leg before, picked up by the captain, Kyle Corbin, at slip. And umpire Michael Nurse would not be fazed by the appeal. And at the completion of the day's sixth over, it is 38 for loss of four in search of a target of 184 after the Police side invited UWI to bat. And more from Andy. And I'll just do one more, and then Keith will come call Andy.
Yeah, well, that one comes. Power player, and you see that at this stage the Police team, they're 36 for four after six overs, scoring at just about 6 points in the over. So, but losing four wickets, setting the run rate really high. I mean, a run rate of 8-9 in your chasing, and you have wickets in the hatch, you still think you're in with a chance. But I mean, with four wickets down, it's a lot of acts. So, after six overs, power player finishes. Now, the team can really relax their feeling, and you really got a lot to do at this stage.
And we're going to have a bowling change at the Malcolm Marshall end. It appears to be the leg spin of Akeem Doar, whose cricket, I would have to agree with Keith, 100% his bowling has definitely fallen away over the last year and a half. But he continues to be a potent force in this side. And it's a side that most teams gun for besides Maple. Any form.
Yes, Yui is to beat team, and lots of teams want to beat Yui, but Doar, he used to be a really of a thorn in a lot of teams' a couple of years back, but people say he's gone off the ball somewhat now.
And his first delivery is slapped down to the fielder off the cover boundary. They will take one. So Williams, who is also not an aggressive batsman, likes to work the ball in the V and square, but he takes his time. And in an instance like this, a rate does not allow you for time because the asking rate is 9.8 odd.
Especially, like we said, the idea with the relaxation of the field after the power play. It's a big for Williams.
39 for the loss of four. As Dwayne Yearwood is driving, doesn't make any contact, through to keeper Bramble. First time I'm seeing Bramble behind the stumps.
Well, new players in this UV team this year, Yardi, you just need to get familiar with them.
Well, here is a short delivery pull out to the fielders across to his left at mid-wicket, and they'll take one. So one, obviously, would not help police cause at the moment. 40 for the loss of four, with Yearwood on 22. The current rate is 6.15, and the required rate 10.67. Here is Akeem Duar on his way into bowl to Williams, and he plays a booming drive. Doesn't make any contact. And you can safely say at 9.17, Andy, that the law, they're definitely under pressure. As here is a delivery squirted out the point. There's a chance for a round. The return comes in, hits the base of the stump, and umpire Michael Nurse, once again, maintains his 100% record. He signals not out, and it is 41 for loss of four, but a close call there, Andy.
Yeah, good feeling again from the field at that battle point area. It looks like Carter. Very agile, very nimble, good return, direct hit. But again, Nurse was saying Yearwood was in pretty easily.
A very good all-round cricketer. He can bowl spin, he can wait, keep, he can bowl medium pace, which he prefers. And an excellent batsman when he gets going. One of the better batters in Barbados. And there's a drive straight through the bowler's hand. It will come down to the fielder at the long off position. And they will take one. So such is the deterioration in the cricket of Akeem Duar. That's the catch that Andy should have been taken.
Yeah, two seasons ago, he would have doubled that.
Correct. And at the end of the seventh over, in search of a target of 184, I can tell you police there are backs against the wall. 42 for loss of four. Dwayne Yearwood, 23 from 21 deliveries with three fours. With him is Roger Williams, 5 from 7 deliveries. And quickly said bowler figures, Kevin Hodge, 3 overs, 1 minute, none for 8. Nino Henry, 2 overs, 1 minute, 1 for 25. Jonathan Carter, 1 over 4, 5 runs with 1 wicket. And Akeem Duar, 1 over 4, 4. You'll hear more from Andy Payne, and he'll be joined by the voice of Keith Oler.
Good start by the war at that time. He's just going for 4 runs in that over. But you can see the guys trying to go hard. You just need to get some bat on ball. Just get some more singles and set it up. But singles, when the run rate is now gone up to something like 10.9, so that's a bit asking, especially with 4 wickets now, Keith.
Indeed, Andy, and Hodge in his 4th and final over, as the score moves to 43 for 4, the 8th over of the police innings. He has a solitary slip going around the wicket, and forward a big appeal for leg before wicket. Nuthuk says umpire Michael Nurse. I recognize that Lyndon has been giving my good old mate a tough time, Michael Nurse, and I've known him for donkey years, both at primary and secondary school. And he used to hit the ball hard, played a bit of BCL cricket, but he knows his game, trust me, as this one is defended back on the pitch to the bowler. His father used to captain Podricks in the BCL. Kiffy Nurse used to really give the ball a blast, and Michael knows his cricket from way back when as a toddler, watching his dad play, and now he has turned to umpiring. But to be honest with you, he's said to be an umpire who favors batsmen.
Very astute type of fella. I was a light nurse in my time.
43 for 4. Hodge, as usual, very tight as in and pushed out on the onside towards mid wicket. There's no run. Roger Williams, the captain, coming into this match under cloud, injured his shoulder in the necks on Tuesday but passed the fitness test. And I have a question for Andy at the end of this over. Back goes. And a big appeal again for leg before wicket. Michael Nurse comes up and says that's the end of the over. And 8 overs have been bowled. Hodge again, as usual, very, very tight, finishing with 4 overs, 1 maiden, none for 9. It's 43 for 4, with Dwayne Yearwood on 24. Roger Williams has 5. And Hodge, look at these figures for the season, Andy. Against Spartan, 4 overs, no maidens, 1 for 9. Versus Empire, 2 big guns. 4 overs, no maidens, 1 for 3. versus Carrington, 4 overs, 1 middle, 3 for 9. Against Lyme, 4 overs, no middles, 1 for 20. Versus Commonwealth, 4 overs, no middles, none for 14. And now tonight, 4 overs, 1 middle, none for 9. You could have won it better in T20 stuff, 43 for 4, Andy.
That's good bowling throughout, anything.
Losing his back, that's a second slug. And for the second time, perhaps the gloves with a bit of sweat. And
I think he's also lost his stump.
Yes, bowled with a big heave. And what a way to be dismissed, as Akeem Dor, nicknamed Pinky, is being congratulated by his teammates. And police set for a big defeat here at Kensington Oval tonight in the Sagicor General T20 Championship, the second quarterfinal, now losing their fifth wicket. Dwayne Yearwood, bowled by Dor for 24 from 22 balls with 3 fours. It's 43 for 5 after 8 overs and 1 ball.
That's really put the police back. I mean, less than half the overs bowled and they've lost half the wickets. So, and chasing a big total to keep 184. They're really behind the eight ball at this point. But if we go back to this guy, Hodge, 4 overs, 1 made it number 1 for 9 tonight. And I've just shown his figures throughout the entirety of the competition to this day. He's a really of a tight bowler. And to have that type of guy bowling at the top of your order, especially if he's second up, really puts your team in perspective, in a good position. So his figures, I don't think he's gone past 20 in his 4 overs in any game so far, Keith. So that's a trump card for UE. And he gets wickets as well. So that would put any opposition under pressure. So kudos to Young Hodge.
And this delivery goes down towards short fine leg. The question I was going to put to you relates to the gentleman who's now come to the crease, Larry Babb. And in a T20 game, you won't play against the one of Larry Babb, who is one of the renowned hitters and strikes the ball hard and far, rather clean as well. In pretty early, but he's come out with his team in big trouble. 44 now for 5 in the 9th over. This target of 184 is really a mountain now for police to climb. As Dor, the leg spinner, goes in from the Marshall end and broken outside of the off-stop. As Williams, the captain, passes the outside edge and taken by Bramble, the new keeper, with Chadwick Walton, the captain, back in Jamaica preparing for the CPL with the Jamaica Tullowas. A slip has been put in, and this one is picked short, forced out from the own side, up towards the straightest mid-wicket, and they will take one. That's all they will be. UW team rather sharp in the field as Williams, the captain, goes on now to 6 on 4 deliveries. Larry Babb, the left-arm medium player, who bats right-handed. And it's 45 for 5. Made 183 for 5, having been sent in. Carter 51 from 34 balls with the top score. Short, and I don't think this is Babb really, truly. That's his step in building. So the question was asking, do you reckon that there is something perhaps wrong with Larry Babb that he hasn't come out? And Stefan Gooding gets this one out over the edge. Into the keeper. So the end of a successful over from the leg spinner, Akeem Dor, who's in Jamaica. And with 9 overs having been bowled, the police innings in tatters set 184 for victory. There are 46 correction for 5. And Dor has now bowled 2 overs. And he's picked up 1 for 6. With the only expensive bowler being the Pearson, you know, Henry, 2 overs, 1 for 46 for 5. Here is the former BCL batsman and former Maple top league player. What division are you in now, Andy?
Just on the spectator.
Andy Pierce says he's now just on the spectator. Any likelihood of a recall?
It's a possibility. I still like, love the game. I've still been practicing with the guys every now and then.
I thought you were going to tell me if they move the golf.
It's still within close proximity. It's all within close proximity, Keith, so who knows?
Okay, Ryan Hines comes into the attack, and his first delivery, he's appealing for a catch. The ball is struck into the turf, and David Ford, they're really testing my friend Michael Nurse tonight. 46 by Ryan Hines, having his first goal from the game. In with 1, is Stephen Gooding. Roger Williams, the captain, has 6 from 14 deliveries. Hines around the wicket, and struck over the head of the bowler, Paul P. down towards Lamar. And it's a good save made back long off the center for just one. Looks like Boyshees McKinnon comes into the bowler. And 2-0 to Billings. 6 is Billings. 47 for 5. Why no Larry Babb so far?
Keith, you have to think that something's really wrong with Babb. I mean, chasing 184 and Babb, your most renowned hitter of the ball, you need to get him in. I've been speaking to this police team over some time, and I'm saying with the type of player that Babb is, most of the teams open the bowler and spin bowlers, you need to get him out there, especially in the power play when there are only 2 feeders on out. He could be very destructive, and I don't know why the police just keep holding him back.
A late dab for a couple of runs. Rob Williams off the back for the times down to deep cover. They take one, looking for the second, which is one. As the return goes into Justin Bramble, the goalkeeper. And the 50 is up for police. So a bit of consolation, they've managed to put 50 on the board. The halfway stage of their innings. That they were 103-2, so this is a far cry. Police clearly get up to just under what UWA achieved at a similar stage with one ball left in the 10th over. They are 50 for 5. After this over, Linnea Yard is going to be quickly back. These overs go over rather quickly. That's why I have to do my little stuff at the end of the break. So, yeah, Ian Barshaw is going to be a double change. Brady had a long, long, long lunch. I'm certain that he would have washed it down with some good juice. So we're going to have a double change. And Andy is going to make a call to Westmoreland to find out what time he's going to tee off tomorrow morning. And I'll get another break. Perhaps I may not be able to come back on by the way how things are going. But it's 50 for 5. A word from Ian Bradshaw and then the Bobby Ball commentaries, Lyndon Yard.
Well, Keith, as you get older in life, it's good to take a little break and rest the old bones.
And here's his first delivery from Duar's work up to the long on position. And one more to the batsman. And just gonna go by the scoreboard. 51 for loss of 5. That's one to Williams. It brings Gooden to strike. So Gooden on 10. Williams, Gooden on 2. Williams is on 10. And Duar, where your leg spin hits in the air. The fielder is going back from the cover position and it's going to land in no man's land. The lack of commitment as the fielder running back really ought to have left it for the fielder running. Who had a better look at it, Ian?
Yes, a total miscommunication there by the two players. Carter going for the ball, but you better advise to leave it to the guy running in. At the end, it fell safely.
Patoy patrolling the cover boundary. 3/4 of the way out as Duar bowls a short delivery which is pulled down to backward square. The field is across to his right. That is Kevin Hodges. Return is on his way to the keeper. And taken down by Justin Bramble. The keeper for whom we've seen for the first time. 53? Yes, 53 for the loss of 5 in the process of the 11th over. The target now seems almost a foregone conclusion of 184 as Duar, in the process of his third over, moves into bowl to Gooden, and he flashes it down to the field at the mid-off position, and he'll take one. So one that will move Williams is on 11. Gooden has 4, 54 for loss of 5, and Williams back on strike.
How good was it to get my good friend Andy Payne doing commentary?
Always refreshing to have the old guards. Oh, out the point. And that is no other than Jonathan Carter. And Ian, I said out the point. And it's not only out the point, it is out to the pavilion.
Well, very soft dismissal there by Williams. We asked why he came before Babb. He's not the type of player that will come and rip the ball apart. Same, just failing to execute that inside-out drive. Outside edge just flying tamely to point. Ricardo took the catch. And police slipped further. Now losing their 6th wicket. They've not yet posted 60 runs on the board.
54 for loss of 6. Roger Williams caught by John Ricardo off the bowling of Akeem Duar for 10. 19 deliveries he faced, 22 minutes. And the police really, really being pushed back as Larry Babb finally makes his way to the crease. And he can become a hero if he can really get inside across the line at this stage. You can say it's like good night, nurse. And I think we could well look forward to tomorrow's game. It brings together Lee Bistro Carlton against Pickwick. And that should be one of the better matchups after last night's in Compton.
So, and then also remember the final night will be Andy Payne's Maple versus Ian Bradshaw's Wonders.
It could have been better said. And there is a bow with his first delivery, a booming drive, was sailing the off stump, doesn't make any contact, trying to keep a wide call by the umpire. And it is 55-6.
You know what I found amusing when Andy spoke of his newfound love in golf? I think it's a perfect game for him now because he's a guy that can hear the Sayaka saying, hit the ball along the ground. He doesn't have to worry about that now. He can drive the ball in the ear to his heart's cup content with golf. So
flicked away. Bad delivery, bad line. It will roll close to the bumper and across the ropes for four. And the bad line short delivery is pulled down by Akeem Duwara. And Brad Ian, I would want your comments on Akeem Duwara in the last year and a half. I think his career is really falling off. Now the completion of what has been the 11th over, it is 59 for the loss of 6. I can tell at this stage that the UWI side, they were 107 for the loss of 1.
Yes, Duar, I think his performance last year in particular mirrored that of UE. He just seemed to have lost that aura of invincibility. You know, he could do nothing wrong in the 2013 season. And I guess as players got a bit more of a idea of what he was delivering, they no longer feared his wizardry as it came to leg breaks and googlies. So he'll have a lot to prove this year, and no doubt if he can get back to the form that he had 2 years ago and combined with likes of Ryan Hines and Young Hodge, I think the UE team will have the firepower in their bowling department to cause some trouble, not just in this competition, but throughout the year.
And here is Gooden, takes out the sweep down to the fielder off the square leg position. He will get one, and that will bring Bab into strike. Run number 59, 60 for loss of 6. Gooden moves to 5, Bab comes back into strike, and he has 4 against his name. Hines in his second over, 1.2 overs, no minutes, 9 for 5. Akeem Duar, 3 overs, no minutes, 2 for 15. As Hines is into Bab, and Bab stands up straight to David as he pushes through and plays it out to the fielder at the cover region, and there is no run, so slip. Third man, backward point cover. There's a sweeper on the cover boundary. Long off, long on, deep mid wicket, deep square leg, and there's also an extra cover on the boundary. Is this delivery?
What you notice that Hines is doing, he knows that Bab is very strong down the ground, and he's bowling back a length consistently.
Consistently bowling that length, and there he goes once again down the leg side. The appeal for leg before, umpire Michael Nurse with his hands in front of him is not impressed, and Bab turns and comes back for 2. Leg by is signaled by umpire Michael Nurse. Extras now move up to 6. The leg by is moving to 3. Whites 2. It is 62. For loss of 6 in the process of at the completion actually of the 12th over. So I give you some bowling figures quickly. Nino Henry, 2 overs, no maiden, 1 for 25. Kevin Hodge, 4 overs, no maiden, 4 overs, 1 maiden, none for 9. And he's been very mean all season long. He had identical figures against Carter, 4 overs, 1 maiden, 3 for 9 on that occasion. Jonathan Carter, just a solitary over for 5 runs with 1 wicket. Akeem Duar, 3 overs, no maiden, 2 for 15. And Ryan Hines, 2 overs for 5 runs, 62 for 6. After 12 overs, Ian, they're really out of it.
Yes, very much behind the pace of the required run rate. Now reaching up to almost 16, and it will really take a lot of muscle to power police to a victory here tonight.
And there is Gooden allowing delivery leg break from Akeem Duar to spin into the gloves of Bramble, and there is no run. At this stage, Ian, do they go down fighting, or are they opt for batting practice for the 50 over and the season up ahead?
Well, it makes no sense coming to Kensington over.
In the air, out to long off. The fielder goes back and parries it for 6. Unbelievable. And that ball has been parried over the ropes for six. The fielder comes across to his left. It really was a regulation catch. The signal now coming from the umpire. And that is six runs to the cause of Stefan Gooden. And clearly, the policemen will believe that they're entitled to some chances themselves, having put down three plus a stumper.
Yeah, it's only the second occasion that the ball has cleared the ropes so far in the police innings. And this one was the assistance of one of the UB fielders. So maybe if Gooden can find his range, he's been swinging for all his might, not connecting on too many occasions.
And just a bit of agricultural shot there. The crop season very much in effect. Now probably winding down. So is this game. Now he dances down the wicket and just gets his foot back in time. The ball was a little wide, and it gave him enough time to get back before the keeper, Bramble, can break the stumps. And he lives to survive. He has 11 against his name, 15 deliveries his face. Bob has really been a spectator at the non-strikers, and he has four. And police run out of overs, run out of time. 68 for loss of four in the process of the 13th over. And make that 68. Oh, a drop by Brian, by Kyle Corbin. Unbelievable. And simple catch. Ian following the ball, he followed it, he moved with it, and it was hard to see him put it down.
Great anticipation there by Corbin, realizing the ball was going the way to his right. Did everything right,
except
catch the ball. You can do everything right, you don't get it right at the end, it's no use.
Well, two chances for Gooden in this over. So Akeem Duara about to complete the spell. 3.5 overs, number 2 for 21. And this one is turning right across the batsman, falling just short of the slip. And at the completion of Akeem's Duara spell, 4 overs, no maidens, 2 for 21. Police in search of a target of 184. There are 68 for loss of 6 after 13. The requirement, 42 deliveries, 116 runs still to get.
The value of the wrist spinner in the T20 game. So this is good when the batsmen aren't too certain which direction the ball is going. It's a lot harder to stand and deliver. Duara will be pleased with his returns tonight. As you said before, looking to find that form of 2 years ago.
Here's Brian Hines on the way and balls to Bob. Bob whips this one out to mid wicket. The field is across to his left. And Bob is content with a single. So Larry Bob had him pretty far down the order. And they're really coming in with the police on almost in a no-hold situation. He moves to 5, 69 for loss of 6. As Ryan Hines comes into bowl to Stefan Gooden, and Gooden goes back and pulls it out to the fielder of the square leg position. And he has it under control to take one.
One thing I've noticed in this innings compared to Ewing is there's a lack of urgency in the running between the wickets. The police team really putting the bound before it's under any pressure whatsoever.
And Bob now pulls out the handle, gets it off the inner portion. The bat's going to run pretty close to the boundary. The fielder from short third man is after it, and it'll take two. So two runs to Bob. That one having an almighty heave, hitting the under portion of the bat with a flat delivery that was pushed through. And nonetheless, he picks up two to move to 7. 72 for loss of 6 in the process of the 14th over. The ball is back with Hines, who's getting through his overs pretty quickly. 2.3 overs, no minutes, 9 for 9. He comes in under and bowls to Bob, and Bob uses the long hand and will get one. And will turn to come back for two. The return comes in, return that drives Bramble away from the crease, from the stumps, the basis of the stumps. And the total is now up to 74 for loss of 6. So twos and singles really wouldn't help the cause here for the police side, Ian.
Yeah, once again, not bringing the ball close enough to Bob to allow him to find his range. wonderful job being done here by Ryan Hines. He's coming to this UE setup to replace Floyd Reefer. You know what a sterling job Reefer did over the years as the player coach. It's good to see the senior players in Barbados cricket evolving into new roles. And I can only hope that Hines's tenure at the University of the West Indies will be as fruitful as Floyd Reefer certainly enjoyed. Well, before the inning started, we saw one of the assistant coaches, Ryan Austin, hit a number of high catches to his fielding unit. He will not be pleased with what he's seeing put out here by the University of the West Indies. And as you said before, if they're going to progress in the tournament, they have to feel better than this. It's interesting to see Ryan Hines now coming into the attack. Once again, he's gone for only 12 in his three overs. So it's really applied the screws to the UB innings.
And there is the batsman looking to get after Ryan Hines. And that is Stefan Goodens making it contact through to the keeper. Slip backward point. There's a third man. There's a sweeper on the cover boundary. There's a cover in position. The painful leg before umpire Michael Nurse raises the dreaded finger at approximately 9:45 p.m. So he has to go. And the end of the visual for Stefan Gooden. Police in further trouble. 79 for loss of 7 with Bab Noddle on 12. And the first wicket for Ryan Hines being rewarded for being economical. Three overs before this for 12 runs. At a run rate of just 4, economy rate of 4 flat.
You mentioned Ryan Hines being economical. The umpire has been very economical in his hand movements for the entire night because it's the first time he's put up his hand. Finally, after a lot of pleading, Ryan Hines finally got her decision from the umpire, but he couldn't be any dealt whatsoever to the umpire. That was plumb in front. The UE's team was struck once again, picking up the seventh police wicket. I'm not too sure what the police team will have to celebrate about their performance tonight.
Well, if they go back to the top, they will say they will probably ruin the fact that they would have given away the opportunity to bat first on this wicket. And I think when you come up against a side like UW, I think you have to take the fight to them. They are going to start as raging favourite. They have justified every reason why they should start raging favourite. And with the when you look at the police attack, I do not see how it was better for them to bowl first, unless you believe that what you give away, you can get. But with the attack that they have, they have no leading bowlers of which you can say, well, this bowler will contain or this bowler will pick up wickets. Hence, I suspected that for me, I would rather make first use of the wicket and get as much as possible with the hope that somewhere along the line, we'll be able to contain the UV batting. That's not the case. They're chasing a massive one. Lovely effort there by the fielder at the point region, Toy. And it's now 80 for loss of 7. You're not missing it, cricket. I guess we can talk along the game, basically, where the police say would have gone wrong. And I said, for me, I think looking at their bowling, you've got to look at what you have on paper and transfer it to the wicket and compare both teams. Obviously, as I said, they would have been behind the 8-ball. They are no longer the powerhouses of cricket as they used to be in the late 80s, early 90s. Since the turn of the 21st century, they have been relegated. And with few games where they spark, maybe the 50 over the odd 2020 game, but when you come up against a powerhouse that you need to have dominated in every facet, 3-day, 50 over, and T20, I think I would have more taken my chances batting than having to give them first use, then being asked to chase down a target.
Yes, you're spot on, Linda. And I was very surprised. I'm not sure if they were a little concerned about the rain and the Duckworth Lewis, and so if that had to happen. Certainly, they should have given their batsmen opportunity to bat under pressure. I don't think they are consistent in their batting unit to look to chase down a target. And more often than not, you're going to bet that UE will post a target that will pose some problems.
16 overs gone, 87 for 6. No, 81, sorry, for 6 now becomes 82 as the return comes in from the long on position. And there's now 82 for loss of 7. And I think at this stage, then the police side will probably want to take the rest of the innings to get some much needed batting practice on the legs, because they won't be back on the legs for this tournament for sure. And for UE, I'm sure that Coach Floyd Reefer, Stephen Leslie, the manager, Ryan Austin, the fielding coach, they would be very aware of their lapses in the field, definitely in the fielding department, the catching especially. Here's a delivery which has worked to fielder at point. That is Jonathan Carter. And there is no run. You're not missing any cricket. 82 for loss of 7. Here we can continue to talk along the rest of the game, because to come is Trevor Ayfield and Dwayne Davis, two players with no big reputation. At the crease is Jamar Year. When he has a strike, he's on one. He backs away and slaps the delivery straight down to the fielder at the long off position. That is another single, which will help the cause of police, because presently they require 101 from 21 deliveries, 83 for 7.
Yeah, it's a shame for the Crows come out tonight. We have some visitors in as well. And I'm sure they would have come looking for a more even contest. The police team just being overwhelmed here by a very rampant UE team.
Bob, no, slashes this one down the ground. They go for one. The return comes in and they'll complete two quite easily to the fielder at the long off position. So two more total, 85 loss of 7. And I guess those visitors, if they can stick around to tomorrow, will have a very interesting game between Lee Breestrose, Carlton, and the Pickwick. Pickwick will probably start favorite, having not lost a game in the tournament thus far. But Carlton will believe that they have a good chance, just as good as chance against Pickwick, as opposed to playing, say, for example, a Lyme, a UE, or a Maple. And you yourself, Ian, your side wonders with all to play for, since you'll be your underdogs going that game against the more fancied Maple side.
Well,
Andy's asking if you are the underdogs. But I think Andy's very well aware that your West Indies players are overseas. And here is Jonathan Carter goes back and doesn't take the catch. He let him not to hit the carpet. And catch that, I'm sure, in CPL or playing the West Indies, but I'm sure he would have gone for that in 88 for the loss of 7.
Yeah, probably just saving himself there. Obviously, a lot of work he has to do in the next couple of months. And with the game in hand, probably just let that one go. But the police team just can't seem to find a way to break the shackles. Don't know if they can find anyone in authority to issue a search warrant this time of the night to go into the UE dress room and find some answers. But they've just been really lost here in their efforts. As you said earlier, the order is one that you would have expected someone like Larry Babb to give him a bit more opportunity. There's so much to do right now, even though he's trying his best. He just obviously has too much to do, and he's almost predictable in what he has to do. Just has to go for broke. So the ball is quite wise. He's just trying to keep the ball out of his hidden zones. And he better serve if he was given opportunity a little earlier to bat with some of the recognized batsmen.
I think if you could summarize the game at the moment, you could say that clearly UE is one that's given the mental department.
We all know that UE is a team that prepares very well. They're very professional in their approach for this level of cricket. And you're seeing it here just in the way that they've set their fields and they've rotated the bowling unit.
As Bab waits on Katoy, Kieran Katoy, who's been introduced into the start. I will pick up a rare boundary. And not even applause from the, I would say, 75 odd spectators who have been very quiet tonight in comparison to last night's crowd that was much bigger, much vocal. And it's now 92 for loss of 7. Police seeking an improbable 184 for victory.
It's the seventh bowler being utilized here now by the UE team, and it's wonderful to see the depth in their bowling department. Katoy has done well throughout this tournament so far. A wrist spinner, just like we saw with Duar, and we saw what success he had. So despite the wet conditions, they seem to cope quite well, the UE spinners.
It is 92 for loss of 7. Bab on 21 on strike. 19 deliveries he's faced. And he slaps his delivery straight down the ground. The fielder Van Lamhoff comes across to his right and will intercept. And Bab is going to turn to come back for 2. That will carry him to 23. He's down 94 for loss of 7. Jamar Yearwood is at a non-striker's end. He is now on 4. And he'll give you some updated figures. Ryan Heisey's completed his 4 overs. 4 overs, no minutes, 1 for 14. 4-0, 14, 1. Hakeem Duar, 4 overs, no minutes, 2 for 21, 4-0, 21, 2. Christopher Ramsaran, 2 overs for 11 runs. And there's Larry Babb with a big booming drive. Doesn't make any contact. And Jamar Yearwood wants a single. Babb seems to have hurt himself somewhere or somehow or some fashion. He's peeled the gloves off. And maybe, I don't know if he would want to do a John Graves. Babb with one glove. John Graves, what you understand, though, made a trip to St. John Culture. So, under the advice of his manager, Keith Holder. As high in the air, the keeper is under it. Justin Bramble takes the catch. And the man with the big gloves, you would expect him to take that. So, Larry Babb's vigil also comes to an end for 23. 22 deliveries he's faced. Caught by Bramble off the bowling of Katoy. And police slip further into trouble. 94 for loss of 7. Yearwood not on 4, Ian.
Yes, well.
94 for 8, sorry, in the process of at the completion of the 18th over. So 12 balls, 90 to get.
Yes, and as another police wicket goes, and I understand that the winners of this game will face the winners of the previous game. So it was very much like it would be a line UE semi-final. And both teams would have batted particularly well in the two quarterfinal games.
I think what is also interesting about that setup is the fact that Lime has 4 spinners. And we've already seen 1, 2, 3, 4 spinners from 5 spinners from the UE side as well. So in the bowling department, it's definitely going to be, I would say, head-to-head. No team really has a sizable advantage. Obviously, the pace department does favor the lime setup, but as I said, the fast bowlers on that occasion will have to come and bowl well, and then it can very well come down to the batting powers of both teams. So we are set for a thrilling semi-final for sure. The first one, an umpire Andrew Corbin answers in the negative. The appeals of the UAE players, led by Ryan Hines, and it remains 94 for a loss of 8. 11 deliveries left, 90 runs to get. Richard Graves made no score. Haynes, Ashane Haynes, contributed 11. Dwayne Earle got to 24. A break as there is a Earle flash of the wide instead of the all-stump. That's the fourth wide in this innings. Extras up to 8. 96 now for loss of 8. With another 11 deliveries left. Christopher Ransaran. And this delivery is clouted up to long on. He will get one. And here we're thinking of the second. And he's content with that one run. It brings Trevor Eiffel into strike. He has one against his name. 96 now. Loss of 8. And I'm sure that my very good friend Lesnar Prescott will be very disappointed and despondent at this stage. Her team is going down. Disillusioned, Keith Holder said. Depressed. All of these. Here is Trevor Eiffel hitting this one into the distance along the ground. So we're going to stick with the D's. And I don't know if you have any D to add to that D. 97 for loss of 8.
I just want the end. That's all I want. This is getting very painful now.
So Ian is going for his D as D end. Here is Ramsaran on the way and bowls to Earwood. And through to the keeper, taken by Bramble. And there is no run. So a long night is about to come to an end for the police side. They will regroup and reconsider and reflect on what they have done here at Kensington Overhead in the air. Up to the fielder at the... Oh, he's parried it for 6 once again. That seems to be Nino Henry. He has parried that one for 6. The second time that has been done for today. And that's now the 5th catch that the UWI side have put down. Ian, while they are in control of this game, I'm sure when they reflect, they'll be very sorry, because I always believe whatever you practice is what you preach.
You'd expect that. One of the things that will be.
Just a minute, I can tell you the 100th police has come up off 18.5 overs, 6 fours and 3 sixes. 170 balls for the police 100, 103 for the loss of 8. Ian, you were saying?
Yes, Lyndon. One of the things that the UAE coaches will focus on is their fielding, because you just can't expect that you'll turn it on the big night. So you really want to bring in your A game and be gradually improving throughout the tournament, as I said, peaking at the right time. And despite the fact that they're in the ascendancy, it's important that they keep their standards high. Get that confidence up, because a lot of players don't get to play on under lights. The UAE team, to one team, because of their facilities, they can probably simulate to some degree what they will get, but they really want to be doing it under pressure, under match situations.
Yes, I would agree with you 100% as the 19th over comes to an end, and I can tell you at this stage, police 103 for loss of 8, 103 for loss of 8, with Christopher Ramsaran just having completed his 3rd over, 3 overs, no maidens, none for 20, Kieran Katoy, 1 over for 6 runs with 1 wicket. And we're just down to the final over. And it's going to be Katoy who's going to have the pleasure of bowling the final over. 81 required from 7 overs. That's definitely out of the question, out of the equation. And looking at this performance in comparison to last night's performance, I think it was a very clinical win for the Lime side, who after an opening partnership of 76 forced the pressure on the St. Catherine side. And here's a situation where UAE are in total control, but there is wicket number 9 as Eiffel takes a line swipe. He runs down the wicket, eyes closed, left leg to the harbour, right leg to Eagle Hall, and he's been stumped by a mile. Ian Bradshaw, 108 for loss of 9. 102, sorry, for loss of 9.
He had greater odds in getting the lucky super lotto. No chance there whatsoever. Easy dismissal there for the keeper. And I want to ask you, Lyndon, who do you think will be the man of the match tonight?
Well, clearly you have to go into the UE camp to find the man of the match. And you're definitely not going to find it. If I was to go based on statistics, I'm going to pull a wild card now, and I'll tell you my man of the match would be Kevin Hunch. I'll tell you why. 4 overs, 1 maiden, 9 runs. Why he didn't take a wicket? Look at his economy rate. 2.25. You know, and it's a game where none of the police batsmen showed up whatsoever.
Well, that was a magnificent effort. I think he'll also be rivaled by Jonathan Carter, who picked up a wicket. More importantly, was the lone person who got 50 tonight and did so at a pretty good pace. So I think you're quite right to say that the Man of the Match award will lie within the UE camp. It's just a matter of if they'll lean more to the bowling effort or to the batting effort.
Well, Dwayne Davis has come to the crease, and Keith Holder says that he's picked primarily as a bowler, but Keith has a little thing about him when he comes to bat. And he's already beginning to laugh, so I guess the bet is on. Can he survive the remaining deliveries? He reminds me a lot of David Boone in that built heavy set, crouches over his back, and he swings in the air. Keith Holder is laughing, and it's put down by Kyle Corbin. Catch number 6. Unbelievable. I don't know if Keith Holder would want to describe that. Keith? Ian? 102 for 9 becomes 104 for 9. Big swing. And you call that a mini six or a saucer or a water hole, Ian?
Well, that was a most ambitious shot there by Dwayne. He's my friend, so I'll not take it any further than that.
You're still on the right side of the law.
Still on the right side of the law.
No, here's the turn of Yearwood, and he flashes off the edge, over slip, down to third man, which is unprotected. The fielder runs back from point and overhauls it, and Yearwood will come back for 2. That would carry him now into double figures. He's going to 12 and is now 13, 105 for loss of 9. We have 79 remaining from 2 deliveries. Yearwood has 12. Davis has 1. And Yearwood on strike. Here's Katoy to bowl to Yearwood. He backs away and pulls it out to long on. Dwayne Yearwood in slow motion is ambling down the wicket. And I say slow motion, but that might be full speed. No, Dwayne Davis, sorry.
Well, I think Davis passed and told him, you take it out of that. I'll show you how to hit the ball out the park.
106 for 9. Final delivery. Legit, that is. Of this game. Davis has it straight. And he swings it back to the bowler. Brilliantly caught and bowled. So Davis' visual ends off the final delivery, much to the amusement of Keith Holder. He's been caught and bowled brilliantly too, flinging himself to his left, Kieran Katoy. And for once, the UWA side have claimed a catch. And it's 106 all out, 107 all out of their full allotment of 20 overs. Ian, in reflection, where did the police side go wrong?
You can't come to a match like this and give away the advantage at the toss. Certainly, they missed the plot by not batting first, not making use of a excellent batting pitch. They should have seen it from the night before, where there's runs to be had if you give yourself the opportunity. Obviously, they allow the UE team to take first knock, and they got off to a brisk start under wet conditions, and they never looked back. The police journey through this competition is over, but I can assure you, if the UE team can improve on their catching in particular, they'll be a very tough nut to crack.
Well, I do believe that in their next encounter, which will be the semi-final, I think that will be the first semi-final, Keith, on the 30th of June against Lyme, they will have to bring their A game, and it will be definitely, will need to up the game, their performance in the field itself. The batting was okay, I thought the bowling ball well as usual, but they'll be disappointed with the manner in which that they went about their feeling. They probably took the police side for granted. Obviously, when you look at these 2 teams on paper, obviously UE would have been the firm favourites, and police, as I said, they would have had nothing to lose going into this game, but they always thought that they, having played so hardly to get out of the prelims into this stage. They had nothing to lose, and they should have bought the fight definitely to the UAE side. That was not the case. I think the only thing they did right was win the toss and opted to field first, which was the wrong decision, given the fact that when you look at the team, the makeup of their team, both batting and in the bowling department, I think their stronger side, obviously, with the likes of Larry Barb, Roger Williams, Brian Corbin, and Dwayne Yeo. The experience has to come to the fore, because the likes of Richard Graves, Ashane Haynes, Dario Sargent, the batting is thin from their point of view in terms of consistent scores, even at the Division 1 level or the intermediate level. They don't score consistently to say that they are going to be factored. Because, Ian, one of the things that I noticed at this level that separates a lot of the team is that media pressure. You're playing games where the awareness, the commentary is going, the spectatorship, spectators are always going to be hung in your performance, and you're always on the spotlight in terms of whether you're playing intermediate or the lower division, when there's not that much pressure, they're much more relaxed. So these fellas with no name or no runs behind their back at the lower level, obviously, I don't think their game can be stepped up on the bigger cage. You might have a little spark, surprise and surprise, but it still comes down to the senior pros, the likes of Dwayne Yeo, with his experience of playing probably over 10 years, well over 10 years, Brian Corbin, he's been around, Larry Barb and Roger Williams to a lesser extent. And obviously in the bowling department, they were at least 20 overs short in terms of good bowling to bowl, to put the side under pressure. They did exceptionally well to peg it back in the last 9 overs, because after 11 overs, it was 107 for loss of 1. So to restrict them to 183 was remarkable. But then they did not carry on. Then the second half of the innings where they went totally wrong, totally downhill.
Yes, the police team, an aggressive team by nature, but you need more than just enthusiastic aggression when you come to this stage. You need to be able to execute your skills and execute it over the 40 overs of the match. And over 40 overs, I think they were showing up in the areas of consistency and penetration in the bowling department, and certainly from a batting perspective, they didn't seem to possess the level of batsmanship to put this varied UAE bowling attack under any pressure whatsoever.
So to give you the scorecard for the police side, Richard Graves caught by wicketkeeper Bramble off the bowling of Nino Henry without scoring. It was 1 for none. Ashane Haynes, was run out for 11, 12 for 2. Dwayne Yeo, next out was Dario Sargent. He was run out for 1. It became 25 for 3. 31 for 4. The wicket of Brian Corbin, who was a judge, caught by wicketkeeper Bramble off the bowling of Carla without scoring. From a position of 31 for 4, it became 43 for 5. The wicket of Dwayne Yeo, who was bowled by Dwar for 24, and he would have been the eventual top scorer in the police innings. And he would have been the top scorer in the police innings. 54 for the loss of 5 became became 79 for 6. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 79 for 7, 94 for 8, and 103 with the final wicket falling at 107. So scores and summaries in this game, where police won the toss and asked Sagicor UWA to take first. Not they would have amassed a total of 183 for 5 off their 20 overs, led by Jonathan Carter, 51 and 38 from Cameron Pennyfeather, the top bowler there for the police side, being 2 wickets to Ashane Haynes for 27. In response, the police would have amassed 107 all out off their 20 overs, led by 24 from Dwayne Yeo and 23 from Larry Barb. And the chief record for the UWI side would have been Akeem Dwar. He picked up 2 for 21. And of course, ahead of him, Kieron Kotoi, 3 for 10. That's it from us here at Kensington Oval. Join us for tomorrow's encounter, which brings together Lee Bistro's Carlton and ESA Fields Pitwick. On the behalf of the entire crew, comments person in the form of Ian Bradshaw and Andy Williams, Keith Holder, and the entire broadcast team, and Bell Imagery. Commentary, sponsors, Sagicor General, and the Barbados Cricket Association. Join us tomorrow from Kensington Oval. Good night, goodbye, and God bless.